shadows, run for the shadows in his golden years. Run for the shadows, run for the shadows, run for the shadows in his golden years.
It started with David Bowie. But you know what? Maybe there should be more as we get into the real life of this. And it'll become evident why I used that particular theme song. You probably recognize the scenes that were behind it. Thing is this, we'll start if, by the way, a good question asked on this is that there is an evening service. And we're going to cover other angles of things that we aren't covering this morning. But that being said, the same thing we've been in Revelation. We're taking a break. We're into the Easter week. But the same principle stand still is we're looking at Palm Sunday is an epic event, is it not? It's one of the major things of the New Testament. And especially in epic events, there's never just one story. There's always angles to the story. And there are several angles, several sub-stories, if you will, that we could take to the triumphal entry, as we call it, Jesus coming in during the Passover week into Jerusalem. There's the great story in history. For example, we spent time there in the past. To me, the most fascinating of everything. There's the Pharisees on the city wall telling Jesus to silence the crowd, and then Jesus telling them, if I make them silent, these very stones will cry out. Well, that isn't just waxing poetic. There is a reason behind those stones. Let me show you a picture of history here, if you will. Where is this man standing? The Wailing Wall, which is history. What's the history? The stones. The stones are history. As Jesus was coming up to the city walls, the eastern gate, and they tell him, silence everybody. He said, these very stones would cry out. What he's saying is that there is so much history. Just imagine if those stones had eyes, what they could have seen. We can go back before there was an Israel. We could go back to, you know what the name Jerusalem means? It means New Salem. Before Jerusalem was Jerusalem, when it was still Salem, these stones in the city wall would have seen Abraham come and pay tribute to Melchizedek. The prototype, the person who was an example of what the Messiah would be in time. If these stones were able to see and speak, they could tell about the golden years, as David Bowie sings, of Israel, when King Solomon had that fantastic temple that was standing there in the walls. If these walls and stones had eyes, they could talk about a rebellious Israel several centuries later that Babylon came in and didn't leave one on top of another. Or we could go a century after that to an incredible miracle where the stones are replaced on each other under Nehemiah. All this miracle setting up, all of it was pointing to this Messiah who would eventually and ultimately come. And here, after some 2,000 years of history, here he is coming through this gate, just as prophesied. He's being told, silence the crowd, and he says, if I make them silent, these stones cry out. There's history in them. Or we could talk about the sub-story, the story that's happening in the opening, or happening in the open. Consider what was going on there in the open. There's Jesus entering through the city gate. Ancient Jerusalem at the time was some 100,000 people. When Passover came, which is, of course, also Easter week. They overlap, not surprising. But at Passover week, even in ancient Jerusalem, the population swelled to over 2 million. Can you imagine the energy in a city that swells to that number? Everybody there for the same reason. Everybody there in a unison of belief. And then to top that off, this is a special one. This is what we call Palm Sunday. There's a story about a Messiah actually coming. So some thousands of people line the streets by the gate, and they're all shouting, 10,000 people in unison. Can you imagine? We did pretty well in here for a small crowd, but imagine some 10,000 all in unison, Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. The energy. Can you imagine the nervous looks of the Roman soldiers? What's going on? They're there to keep peace. And, you know, when crowds get big and they get noisy, things can happen. Imagine the glares of the religious leaders looking down from the city walls. All of this going on. We could talk about just what happened in the open, just what you saw with your eyes. But we're not going to do any of that today. We're going to the third story here, the story in the shadows. Run for the shadows. What story is that? Well, see, there was a plot that was being formulated that would soon come to fruition, and it happened in the shadows of the temple pillars. It happened in the back rooms of the Sanhedrin. There was something the religious leaders were doing, but they wouldn't be admitting it publicly. And really, that whole story revolves around a resurrection. Not the resurrection, a resurrection. There was someone else who was resurrected shortly before this whole Easter thing happened. For breaking rights, whose resurrection was that? Lazarus. It all revolves around that. And where we're going with this is what happens when a people face a hard truth. And that's where we're going to get into this. But let's start in the shadows, if you will. In John 12:9, it says, the mob of the Jews knew that Jesus was there, and they came not only because of Jesus, but to see Lazarus, who he had raised from the dead. Here we go. The chief priests plotted to kill Lazarus too, because many of the Jews were withdrawing from them because of him, and were coming to believe in Jesus. Now, Lazarus lived in Bethany, which is some 5 miles from Jerusalem. You can imagine the news spreading when just 5 miles, when somebody's raised from the dead, how quickly that news would travel. So there are witnesses there to this thing. There are those who heard from the witnesses and all of this. So you got in this crowd of thousands of people waving palm branches, just like our kids were doing up here. They were there. Some of them were just, I heard this guy raise someone from the dead. And I hear even that guy's going to be here. I want to see this. So you had people there for all kinds of reasons dealing with this resurrection. Trouble is, if this is true, if this really happened, just like these firsthand witnesses say, it changes everything. If this is true, it changes everything. Not just on the Messiah, their idea of afterlife, everything changes with this truth. Why this Messiah is coming on a donkey instead of on a war horse, or why the situation is unfolding as it is. Well, that's okay, right? Because everybody who's religious, the reason we're religious is because we're after the truth, right? Wow, dead silence. I know you're out there. I can hear you breathing. But the fact is, if we're honest, that isn't true. It's not even our human nature. Really, truth isn't the top priority in our human nature. It's fine. We're all for it. As long as it's not too uncomfortable, as long as it's not too painful, then truth's a fine thing. As long as it's not inconvenient, then truth's a fine thing. Really, in our human nature, our real default position in our human nature is not towards truth, but really a kind of convenience, if you will. So let's continue in the story now that we were honest with ourselves a little bit. On the next day, the great crowd that was coming to the feast heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took branches of palm trees and went to meet him. They kept up a shout, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, he who is the King of Israel." Jesus found, and Kathy said, change the word, say donkey. So as you read along, that's what I'm saying. Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it as it stands written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion. Look, the king is coming, sitting upon a donkey colt." At first, the disciples did not realize the significance of these things. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written about him, and that they had done these things to him. The crowd who were with him testified that he had called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from among the dead. It was because they had heard that he had performed the sign that the crowd went out to meet him. Lazarus is a centerpiece in Palm Sunday. Somehow we'd never seem to mention that a lot. So the Pharisees said to one another, "You can see that all the steps you have taken have been completely ineffective. See, the whole world has gone after him." Here's what it's getting at. Here are these religious leaders who their profession should be truth, right? Truth doesn't come into the argument at all. Truth's not in the mix at all. It's all about, this is inconvenient. This is dangerous. This is, you know, it's other things that become the point. When truth isn't the priority, and here's where it starts coming back in. It's fine talking about these people of the past, but this is coming to a dynamic that you and I live by at this very second. When truth isn't the priority, when it becomes convenient, then there is another path we will naturally take. And here's how it played out for them, because these religious leaders, really all they are for us today are a case sample. We're using them as a case study. But the chief priests took counsel that they might also put Lazarus to death, because on account of him, many of the Jews went away and believed in Jesus. Now, here they are, and we can't really be too judgmental, because as I already established, or we've already talked about, is that there's a default position we have when truth is either painful, inconvenient, whatever. We try to bury it, avoid it, kill it, whatever. So they're only doing, now hopefully none of us in here have gone as far as killing other people, but I'd be more than willing to bet that we've killed the truth in some area, in some aspect, in some way in our lives. And that's where we're going, the human dynamic. I'll give you an example for me, because you know what, you think pastors, well, wow, our job's the truth. We tell the truth all the time. That's what we're about, right? Just as an example, and I've probably been as guilty as this fellow pastor of mine, but in the community of pastors that we're meeting out here, we did really well, and we do really well when we get together. But there was one issue in doctrine that one other pastor really, he just saw things differently than I did, which is fine. We don't have to be the same. But he pushed hard on this point, pushed hard. I said, you know, really, people won't believe the truth on this. There you go. I said, that's fine, because I'm with you. If it's true, then let's believe it. I said, but I have trouble with that because of scripture. And so I sent him a 9-page dissertation, just scripture after scripture, that gave me problems with this issue, whatever it was. And conveniently, somehow, when we met again, I said, well, did you happen to look through this? Oh, no, I didn't get that email, or no, I didn't get time to read that email. It's interesting, and I don't blame him, because I'd be willing to bet I've done the same thing. I know I have done the same thing through my history. As I study scripture, there are times when we do this at some scripture, it doesn't quite fit in with the way I see things, so I'll just give it a wide berth. Or I might just give it kind of a thin explanation. Well, that really means da da da. And it, well, what about the other five that seem to say the same thing? Well, they're just saying this. And you get into explaining things away. Is it really much different? For whatever reason, you know, here we are skirting something that maybe we should be embracing or at least wrestling with. All I'm doing so far is this, is saying, here is your human nature. You and I are no different from that pastor or these Pharisees or whatever. We all will kill the truth if it gets too painful. Or that will be our default position. That's what we will be in human fallen instinct tend to do. So what is really the enemy of truth? So I needed to put one word to it so we can know what we're talking. So here's the word I see as I look at the case study of all of these religious leaders in the time of Palm Sunday. The enemy of truth was really comfort. That's the word I will put to it. How so? Well, we got to touch a little bit of history just to set up the background of this. Here we are. What's the situation? You've got Rome. You've got the Roman Empire. Smart, expert bunch of guys. You know how they ruled the world? It wasn't through war. War was a tool, but war costs money. So what they would do is get in cahoots with the leaders of whatever nation or people that they were involved with. And as long as the one objective was keep the peace, keep the peace. Pay your taxes to us and keep the peace. Do that, we're golden. So these guys were golden boys. So you had the Israel, who was a theocracy still at this time, technically. The religious people were the ones who ran the country. So you had them kind of broken into, we might say, three groups. You have the high priests who were there by lineage and such, and they were obviously big into the law. You had the Pharisees, who were a religious political group, and they're kind of like some of the moral groups that we have today, but they were a very strong religious political group. Believe very much in the scriptures, were very much about the Messiah coming someday. These were the guys who, I'll tell you when the Messiah is coming, he'll be on a war horse and he's going to come in and kick out these Romans. That's the way they were going to interpret the scriptures. That was core to them. That was their hope. Then we have the Sadducees. And the Sadducees were the empiricists of the day. So here's the law. We believe in the word of the law. All of this talk about afterlives and spirits and all of that stuff, pooey. You know, what you see is what you get. And that's the way of life. You don't see it, it's not happening. So everything they believed in was set up in that way. The group somehow got along, kept the peace, got along with Rome, and they were doing okay. So what they had was, starting with, was material comfort. You know what? It's that idea, you're a high mucky-muck in the government. That's a biblical word, mucky-muck, you look at it, it's, I don't know if it's Greek or Hebrew. Anyway, they were up there. Well, they were the guys who got all the money. They were the people who were living comfortably. So if anything went wrong, Rome was fine until you didn't do your job. Once you couldn't keep the peace, you're out. It's not a far step from there to a cross, you know. They would take care of you. So they were very big on this thing. So what if this Messiah thing was true? What happens is that's very inconvenient for their comfort, isn't it? Everything's about to get turned upside down. That can't happen. We can't let that happen. So no wonder they were worried about it all. Much different from today? CEOs, politicians, even pastors, how far will they go sometimes to cover the truth? A scandal happens, something wrong happens. The truth should be revealed and accounted for, but yet we don't. Yeah, we have a habit of covering the truth in our nature. Well, it was the comfort, but there was also the situational situation that as this thing was going on, and as long as they had the people pacified, like we said, not only were they earning money and all of that, there was a status thing going on. You were in power, and power carries all its own perks. How different are we from that? How different are we when our power or status is put into jeopardy, when things become inconvenient? What if biblical truth cost you your job? What if biblical truth cost you your favorite hobby or your favorite TV program or a nice day on the lake? What if truth became inconvenient? How different are we really from these guys? And the last, and maybe the most in this comfort thing, the third angle is religious comfort. Here they are. I already explained a little background what the Pharisees thought. They had their idea, this is what the Messiah was going to look like. He's going to become, he's going to kick out the Romans. How convenient. You ever notice how we can do that with our faith? Is what we want most is somehow fits in with our faith. For them, they've been oppressed. It just makes sense. What we want is a leader who's going to come in, kick out our oppressors, take over, and we'll rule the world. I mean, it sounds great. Yeah, funny how that works that way. The Sadducees had a whole different view. They didn't really see a literal Messiah because there's no afterlife. That's all pooey. What if somebody came and they actually came back from the dead? Well, wouldn't only prove the Messiah, that'd be proof into an afterlife. What if this person controlled and the whole thing that after death there really is something going on and people are being raised from the dead? Wow, your whole religion just got turned upside down. What you spent all your life learning and thinking and set your power and your status now is not really the way it is. The truth is a little bit different. As it's so surprising, they said, we're going to make these guys disappear. You know, we got to make these guys disappear. How different are we? Here's an example. It's not that long ago. William Barclay, someone I tend to refer to often, he's a scholar from an earlier generation, but he is back in the time when Darwinism was just coming into vogue, if I may say. And you know what? That was pretty daunting. Scientific observation. You ever see Origin of the Species? It's about this thick. You know, it's a big book. Very daunting information. He recalls overhearing a couple of church ladies talking, and basically the conversation went, I hope this is not true, this whole Darwin thing, this evolution. But if it is, we've got to hush it up. Wow, is that what we want? A faith system that if something challenges us, we're just going to hush it up. We're just going to avoid the truth, whatever it may be. Now, that's not an argument. As a matter of fact, my problem with evolution is if that's the way it worked, fine, but there's too many scientific inconsistencies. But it's dealing with science for me, not faith, as far as that goes. Side issue altogether. The point is, what do we do when something challenges our comfort? Be it status, be it comfort, as in our material comfort, be it in our religious comfort. And boy, you know, Christians never try to get comfortable religiously, do we? We never do that. Yeah, pat yourself on the back. Here's the big takeaway. I said we could come at this at several angles. This is a big story, the big event that happened in history. But the one we are concentrating on is the one in the shadows. And it's not just the shadows of the pillars of the temple. And it's not just the shadows in the back rooms of the Sanhedrin. It's the shadows in us. It's the ones we deal with ourselves. Because it's all too easy, even in our religiosity, even in our faith, to sidestep truth a little bit if it gets too inconvenient, if it turns things upside down on us a little bit. So here's what I encourage us towards in all of this is, one is just to qualify, I don't believe we have to. That means we need to accept everything that comes down the pike. You might remember, everybody seems to know this quote in some form or another from the beatnik poet Lawrence Ferlinghetti. He's the one who coined that phrase, if you're too open-minded, your brains will fall out. You ever hear that one? You know, too open-minded. So it's not a case of accepting everything. It might even be like my pastor friend who presents an idea that sounds very reasonable, very acceptable on the surface, but under closer observation, sorry, can't accept it. So we might end up in a position where we don't accept something that is said. My question is, what's the motivation though? If something you hold as your pet doctrine, or something you hold as boy, that's the type of person you are, and then the truth challenges it, what's your motivation for accepting or not accepting? Is it the truth, or is it simply avoiding the pain or the inconvenience? Well, you know, we could come back and say, well, let's just get this. We live in a time where truth's relative anyway. So why bother with this if truth is uncomfortable, if it's painful, if it's inconvenient, then why bother with it anyway? That's where we have to come back and look at the faith in which we believe, at the core of it. I'm going to quote Jesus a few times. Hey, imagine that. John 14:6, Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus doesn't speak the truth. Jesus is the truth. John 8:31, then Jesus said to those Jews who believed in him, if you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and then the truth will do something. Guess what? It will set you free. Wow. Here we are. Do you catch this? You see, coming to Canaan won't set you free. You know, even your Christian belief won't set you free. The truth will set you free. And the truth is not just a belief of some kind. The truth is a person. It is Christ himself. The truth will set you free. Here's the problem then that we'll run into in our Christianity is that on one hand, God is truth. God, that's who he is. And on the other hand, sometimes we in ourselves, we want to avoid the truth. We'll skirt around scripture, we'll avoid, turn a blind eye. We do all kinds of things all the time. It can happen to us. But here's the problem we run into. If God is truth and that we have this instinct to kill truth, how do you make that work? How do you make that work? One or the other has to give way. Either your human instinct or your supernatural, transformational, spiritual life. And it will never come naturally. We will always avoid pain. We'll always avoid inconvenience. We'll always avoid anything that threatens our comfort. But when it does, you're a sentient being. You have a spirit. You have a soul. You have free will. What will you do with that? Will you kill the truth? Will you avoid it? Will you bury it? Or will you embrace it? Oh, I'll embrace it. Oh, will you? Will you really? Every time that it's painful. Every time that it's inconvenient. Every time that it is Christ setting you free, but it's not too much fun. We could sure think of a lot of scenarios in the way this goes. So with Palm Sunday, for all the beautiful things we could talk about, the challenge I would offer you for this Easter week is this. The truth can be painful by times. What will you do with it? What will be your motto, your MO for life with it? Embrace it or kill it? Embrace it or bury it? Live in the shadows, live in the light.
Run for the shadows in his golden.